Courage is the price that life exacts for granting peace. The soul that knows it not knows no release from little things, knows not the livid loneliness of fear, nor mountain heights where bitter joy can hear the sound of wings.
Sound of Wings.
Good evening, I'm Tom Green.
And I'm Connie Carpenter.
Tonight, Nine Sports takes you for 2 weeks of bike racing through the American West, from San Francisco to Boulder.
You know, the Coors Classic really is the premier cycling event in the United States, and one element that's earned it that honor is the size of the challenge.
Looking at the challenge simply, the men in the race face over 1,000 miles of riding in just 14 days. The women, almost 400 miles over 9. In these miles, the racers will face such obstacles as the Rocky Mountains, desert heat, and maybe even more important, the constant mental battle to keep coming back day after day. Physical recuperation is a habit that every good stage racer gets into. On many days, there are two races, and in the quest for the consistency that all winners develop, these athletes place almost as much importance on their physical recovery as they do on their physical performance. Sometimes after a long, tough road race, you'll see the riders at their van, seemingly drained of life. It would be wrong to say that the racers shrug off these physically expensive rides. They do hurt, and only the best can rise above. But to race in the Coors Classic, you must have resiliency as well as the conditioning to bounce back, and oftentimes compete again just hours later. To win, you must ride well every day. Your cumulative time determines your overall standing.
The race began in San Francisco with a prologue time trial, an event designed to loosen up the racers and give everyone a time, thus giving the race a leader all the way through to a last place rider. This time trial is the shortest event of the Classic at just over 1 mile. A climb through the steep city streets of San Francisco, including a 22% grade on Grant Street. There was a large crowd along the course, but it seemed that most had come just to see what a world-class cyclist could do on such an imposing climb. The winner of this event would be Ron Kiefel from Colorado. For the fourth straight year, he would start the Coors Classic in first place. For other riders, the hill would be more than their bikes could handle. Alan McCormick of the Killians team lost time when his chain broke, and he had to make a change. The next day would be the actual first stage of the 1986 Classic, and Ron Kiefel, for his time trial the day before, would wear the jersey that all the racers wanted, the red and white leader's jersey, both a proud symbol of success and the curse that having something that everyone else wants can be. The wearer of the jersey is a hunted man. The first race was the San Francisco Wharf Criterium. On a cool Bay Area day, the men negotiated a flat, winding course for 45 laps. In only its second year in San Francisco, the race drew the largest crowd in its history. Spectators scrambled throughout the hour and a half for almost any vantage point. The race became a four-man event when Bob Roll, Alan McCormick, Toon Van Fleet, and Roy Nickman left the field behind with a strong break. As they made for the sprint home, Roll led, but on the last turn, McCormick dropped slow. Roll then dives for the corner and has to swerve to avoid the Irishman. So as they hit the final straight, McCormick has a good line and Roll is trying to stay out of the crowd.
Here they come out of the straightaway. It is Bob Roll in the red, white, and green of 7-11. Alan McCormick of Killian's Ireland. Killian's red, Irish ale, Alan McCormick!
Despite a first stage win, McCormick would not be the race leader. His broken chain of a day ago left him behind the runner-up Van Fleet in the overall standings. So a bittersweet win for the Leprechaun, who fate would not let wear the coveted jersey. Monday, August 11th. The Coors Classic's first road race, a 102-mile ride from the wine country of Sonoma to Sacramento. It is also the first of 4 days during the race where the men would be asked to ride two events in one day. The road race featured the backbone of stage racing, climbing. The racers left a foggy Sonoma and were immediately faced with a 1,700-foot climb in just 3 miles on Trinity Grade. The 1,000-mile race was barely 50 miles old when it came to an end for many. The hills are where the contenders leave the pretenders behind. The race was over halfway run when a group of five took off and began to open a huge gap between themselves and the field. The group included pre-race favorite Greg LeMond and a little known from the Peugeot team named Bruno Cornier. As the fog of Sonoma gave way to the summer heat, the group headed for the California State Capitol in Sacramento with an astounding 7-minute lead on the field. As the five got closer to the finish, Cornier gambled and took off on a solo attack. The four other contenders let him go. They would not see him again. One reason is Cornier would opt for a different route than the one planned by race organizers. Operating without proper guidance by race officials, Wrong Way Cornier makes the first of two wrong turns on the threshold of victory and begins a very dangerous search for the finish line, now off the course and fighting Sacramento street traffic. As Cornier was hunting around, the four racers he had been with for so long were sprinting for what they thought was second place. Greg LeMond was surprised to hear himself called as the winner.
I knew I had second place. That's all I was concerned about. And it's normally he wins. I mean, it would be a scandal if he didn't win.
It was about a minute later that Cornier came down the last stretch, bewildered, betrayed, and cheated out of a great win.
Should have been the winner, young Bruno Cornier.
Just 1 kilometer before the line, once again I left the circuit because I couldn't see the right way, and I was in the jam and I couldn't find the real way.
The leading rider, who had an advantage of 20 seconds at the last split, was twice directed from the race route. The race officials are going to declare Bruno Cornier the stage winner.
So Bruno Cornier would wear the jersey, joined by LeMond and three others, with a comfortable 7-plus-minute lead over a devastated field. To many, the race appeared to be down to those five the rest of the way. The scene moved about a mile in less than 6 hours for the old Sacramento Criterium, the only course where the racers face cobblestone streets, something seen in European races on occasion but rare in America. The problem was, a smart racer, meaning one always looking for an edge like Alan McCormick, had an option on whether to ride on the cobbles or not. He really didn't have a legal option, he just created his own. Unfortunately for the Leprechaun, this was not to be his night. He had put himself in good position for the final sprint as the racers made the last turn. He's in fourth, when on the straightaway he misshifts and hooks his handlebar in the fence. He spins to the ground, bringing other riders with him. 7-Eleven racer Davis Finney won the race ahead of Steve Bauer. But the concern was for McCormick, who had a head injury as well as assorted other damage.
I got a terrible wallop off my head. I got concussion, and I just hope the lump goes down for tomorrow.
The tomorrow that McCormick mentioned was the Classic's longest stage, and it would be on the road from Nevada City to Squaw Valley that Greg LeMond's teammate and number one rival Bernard Hinault would rise once again to haunt him.
You know, I don't like fighting at all. I've had the whole Tour de France to fight with Bernard Hinault, and I came here to relax and enjoy myself, and it's been far from that.
It was on the fourth day of the Coors Classic that the longest race would be run, 119 miles from Nevada City to Squaw Valley. And while the climbs and descents on this course should have determined the race, instead it was a lackadaisical field that allowed a group of eight top-flight racers to escape right out of Nevada City and explode out to a lead that peaked at an unbelievable 15 minutes. With their lead so secure, the feed zones, where the racers get desperately needed body fuel, resembled rolling restaurants, with relaxed racers munching casually down the highways. While the leaders were making it look easy, Alan McCormick was suffering terribly. His crash the night before had left him with two broken bones in his left hand, and it was not too long before he was well behind everyone. He tried to get a rolling repair from the medical van, but common sense prevailed, and McCormick threw in the towel en route to Squaw Valley. Meanwhile, the lead group, one that included five-time Tour de France champion Bernard Hinault, was beginning to sizzle on the way to the finish line. Once in Squaw Valley, it was Phil Anderson holding off Olympic bronze medalist Dag Otto Lauritsen for the win. More importantly, it pulled the eight riders who made the breakaway back into the race as they picked up a Coors Classic record 9 minutes on the field that included the race leader Cornier and Greg LeMond.
And ladies and gentlemen, the winner of today's Nevada City to Squaw Valley Road Race, Phil Anderson of Levi's.
It was nearing an hour after the winner had crossed the line and the award ceremony was winding down when a lone rider appeared. Struggling to finish, it was world amateur champion Lech Piasecki. 80 miles from race's end, Piasecki had suffered a bad crash. Badly bleeding, he took the best first aid available and courageously pedaled 80 mountainous miles. After finding the finish line through the crowd, he was taken directly to the hospital. Piasecki was estimated to have lost about a pint of blood on his solo journey.
Ladies and gentlemen, in his brand new, spanking clean, red and white Coors Classic race leader jersey, Dag Otto Lauritsen.
So while many had speculated the race had only five possible winners after Sacramento, there were now eight new additions to the list of contenders, and the famous Greg LeMond-Bernard Hinault battle appeared ready to heat up again, as they would duel the rest of the way.
Despite its initial appearance, cycling is a team sport. Each team features a racer who is their designated leader, the star of the team. He is the one they all try to help push towards the leader jersey. But the Red Zinger team boasts the two best riders in the world, Bernard Hinault and Greg LeMond.
Non, je crois qu'il faut pas avoir d'amertume.
He doesn't feel like there is bitterness. He feels like that when you have a team that has two champions of this caliber, that there are days when things don't go so well and there are days when things do go better.
Probably the greatest bicycle racer competing in the world today, ladies and gentlemen of the Red Zinger team, Bernard Hinault, race leader.
Hinault is arguably the greatest cyclist ever, having won five Tour de France titles. This year, LeMond won his first Tour de France, the first American ever to win cycling's most prestigious event. Although teammates, both men desperately wanted to win the Tour de France, but there can only be one winner. Hinault will retire from racing in a few months. Between a superstar past and a set future, he is a man very much at ease with himself. LeMond, on the other hand, has a nervous, uncertain side to him, but has gained newfound confidence with this year's win.
Now I have the Tour de France in me. You know, I can approach this more relaxed. Plus, you know, I don't mind. I would like to see maybe Bauer or somebody go for the victory more than, say, Hinault, because there still is a little bitter feeling.
It was at the Tour de France that the battle between the two was fought in a public war of words. And at the Coors, their roller coaster relationship continued.
I don't like fighting at all. I've had the whole Tour de France to fight with Bernard Hinault, and I came here to relax and enjoy myself, and it's been far from that.
And winner of this year's Tour de France, Phil, it's Greg LeMond!
The Greg LeMond you see at a race is tightly wound and intent. The one you probably don't see is quick with a smile and very relaxed. It seems the game of golf has really grabbed LeMond's fancy.
I mean, it's a different type of sport, so it's something I could do. When I'm out here, I completely forget about cycling. I forget about anything that's going on.
Come on!
Back in the bike race, LeMond had 12 contenders to deal with as the fifth stage of the Classic took the race into Nevada, 100 miles from Squaw Valley into Reno. About a quarter of the way into this race, two riders had opened up a six-minute gap between themselves and the field. That made their ride along Lake Tahoe as enjoyable as possible. It was after Tahoe that things heated up. LeMond and Hinault's Redzinger teammate Steve Bauer made a choice. He felt it was time to reel in the Frenchman and the Dutchman off the front. On the descent from Spooner Summit, Bauer took off on a daring solo effort to join the leaders. Reaching speeds above 60 miles an hour, the Canadian, who took the Olympic silver medal in 1984, hunted the pair like a shark after blood. It was over 20 miles later that Bauer's amazing effort paid off, as he completed the task joining the leaders. Despite a memorable effort, Bauer would reap little for his work. Just outside of Reno, the entire chase pack caught the trio, and all Bauer could show for his work would be a hometown win for his Redzinger teammate, Greg LeMond. That same evening, the racers had to be ready for a 30-mile criterium through the biggest little city in the world. It was here a year ago that Steve Bauer fell in the final turn and started a 13-bike pileup that rolled into the spectators. It seemed the riders remembered, as the Reno criterium of 1986 was much safer. But there was the same result, though, as for the second year in a row, Davis Finney cashed in his winning sprint. For finishing second in the race that evening, 7-Eleven's Doug Shapiro earned a 20-second time bonus, meaning 20 seconds would be subtracted from his total time. That put him in a dead-even tie with Dag Otto Lauritzen. For the first time in the history of the Coors Classic, the race lead belonged to two men. After a day off, the race would head to Colorado, where the women's race would begin, and Hinault would use his specialty, the time trial, to take charge of the men's race.
Welcome, Del Hinault!
In Mexico, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jane Marshall, 30 years old, from Albuquerque, New Mexico.
With the scene shift to Colorado also came the addition of the women to the Coors Classic. Their first event would be the Grand Junction Prologue time trial. A long prologue, it would do more than just give each rider a time. It would begin separating the elite from the rest of the field. .6 miles doesn't sound like much, but consistently uphill, it takes a drastic toll on those not ready for the climbing the Coors Classic demands.
Please welcome Maria!
The favorite going in was Tour de France champion Maria Canines of Italy, racing for the Weight Watchers team. But the recently finished tour appeared to have sapped a lot of this great climber's strength, as she would finish the morning time trial in third place. Ahead of her in second place was Jeannie Longo, the defending champion from France, racing this year for the women's Redzinger team. Yeah. The surprise was Inga Benedict. The 7-Eleven racer from Reno took top honors, thus earning the Classic's first women's race leader jersey of 1986.
Let's give the women a great big send-off. Riders ready!
With the prologue done, it was time to start the real racing. For the women, one lap of the Colorado National Monument. The men, coming off a rest day, faced two laps of the same course, known simply as the Tour of the Moon for its lunar landscape. The race at the Coors was openly criticized as being dull last year. The women countered, saying they were never really challenged with a menu of racing that featured too many criteriums. So this year, the race answered with the most challenging Coors women's race in history. On the first day, the field was split early by the aggressive riding of Jeannie Longo, the 1984 champion Canines, and the 1983 world champ Marianne Berglund, now riding for the Centurion team. The three of them stayed off the front all the way into Grand Junction, and at the line, it would be Berglund. With Longo second. For her two second-place finishes, Longo would take over the leader jersey from Benedict. It would be hers to defend.
Longo, race leader.
The men's race quickly spread out as an effective, hard-working break made the two laps with a solid lead and headed into Grand Junction, with the only question being which of the four leaders would take top honors. At the line, Audrey van der Poel of the Holland Pro Team beat Phil Anderson for the stage win. Four. With a good finish, Jeff Pierce of the Schwinn team had all of a sudden taken the race leader jersey. He had finished the seven stages in less time than the rest of the men. The next stop was Aspen. The women raced out to the Maroon Bells and back. Once back in Aspen, they faced 7 2-mile circuits of downtown, bringing the race total to 38 miles. Jeannie Longo made the climb out alone, but elected to descend with the field, figuring they'd probably catch her anyway. It was in Aspen that the vulnerability of racers was again underlined. At these speeds, cyclists have three types of protection: luck, skill, and a hard shell helmet. Well, at least sometimes a hard shell helmet. In the final turn of the race, the fourth rider through was Norway's Unni Larsen. She tried to pedal through the turn, and when her pedal hit the ground, her back wheel flew out from under her. Behind her, Jill Koval had no chance and crashed as well. Falling heavily on her right side, Koval broke her collarbone. The hard shell helmet saved her from a much more serious injury. Koval was to have ridden in the World Championships. Instead, she'll be recuperating. Jeannie Longo went on to sprint for first, clamping down tighter on the overall race lead. The men's circuit at Aspen was the same as the last part of the women's race. Only with 30 laps, they covered 60 miles. The break that dominated this race included some of the best sprinters the Classic had to offer. But the early break split, and with 3 laps to go, it became a two-man race between Steve Bauer of the Red Zingers and Raul Alcala from 7-Eleven. The two of them dogged each other over the last 6 miles, and on the last lap slowed down a while to try and set the other up for a slingshot finish.
Here they come, Brian.
But once the turn was made onto the final straight, it exploded into an all-out war to the finish. Bauer worked out from behind Alcala trying to pull past, but the Mexican reached back for something extra and did not let him by. Over the last 100 meters, the two were side by side, cranking at top speed. At the line, Alcala stole a peek over at Bauer's wheel just to confirm what he thought was a win. His face then reveals what happened. By less than a few inches, a 60-mile race had been decided.
Raul Alcala and Steve Bauer.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Vail. Jeannie Longo!
On Sunday the 17th, the race moved to Vail, and both the men and women would face two events in the high country. The first of which was new to the race, a 10-mile individual time trial to Vail Pass. This event is known as the Race of Truth because all the teamwork, strategy, and planning go out the window. The opponent here is the clock, a relentless opponent with no sympathy. This is the blunt test that riders mentally focus on like no other. They gear their bikes with high-tech help. They wear clothing specifically made for such events. And then they take center stage and concentrate on the task at hand.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Inga Benedict.
In the women's time trial, Inga Benedict used her power to climb back towards the lead, trimming 51 seconds out of Jeannie Longo's advantage. But it was at the men's race where the most amazing ride of the Coors Classic took place. The whole men's field knew the man to beat was Bernard Hinault. And one at a time, they went up to Vail Pass from downtown trying to post a time that the man called the Badger would have to accept as better. When it was time for Hinault, you could look into the face of a champion and see victory. On the hill, the relentless drive that earned him the nickname Badger was intimidating to watch. The altitude, the heat, the 10 hard miles of riding alone, he refused to let them bother him, instead opting to press on, squeezing more out of himself and the air out of the rest of the field. When he finished, he had shattered every time on the board by close to a minute. LeMond was still left to come, but even the Tour de France champ could barely get inside of a minute of the man who would take the overall race lead. For the rest of the field, to see Bernard Hinault in the race leader jersey is like a criminal seeing Clint Eastwood with a 45. Your choices are merely what he wants them to be. The Vail criteriums were in the afternoon, and like she would do whenever necessary, Jeannie Longo took back time lost to Benedict in the time trial. Longo won the race, so she took the 32nd first place time bonus. Her lead over Benedict was back up to 1 minute and 45 seconds. The men's field still seemed to be dazed by the Bernard Hinault time trial from earlier in the day. Most of the racers were content just to ride around and not get hurt. Five racers, though well out of the competition, elected to ride hard, and the combination of two attitudes allowed them to lap the field. In the final sprint, it was former race leader Toon Van Fleet with the win. To catch Bernardino the next day from Vail to Copper Mountain would be the key, and the opposition gathered to pull out all the stops.
Get enough of a gap, do the bike change with the disc wheel.
The rider who wins the Coors Classic has achieved a plateau that very few will know. And while the individual has responded to every challenge, the team will almost invariably be the difference.
Teamwork is crucial to the success of the individual, and it doesn't happen by accident. Each racer has a general role to play, but the team gathers before each race to discuss the specifics. They discuss the tactics, the course, and the opposition, and what they hope to accomplish each day.
This is probably one of our last big chances for anything to happen with the team. If it doesn't happen today, we can probably forget about trying to win team.
It's the morning of the Vail to Copper road race, and two teams get ready for the 81-mile ride that crosses two mountain passes. The 7-Eleven team huddles, scheming to win the race.
Attack. You got nothing to lose by going for it today. Attack, attack. You go, bullet goes.
The concern is for what the Red Zinger team will do, with LeMond and Hinault appearing ready to square off for the race lead.
And Bernie is in this altitude, can only ride steady tempo. He can't do the go fast, go slow, go fast, go slow.
Meanwhile, at the Schwinn team meeting, Jeff Pierce is near the top of the standings, so he runs the meeting, giving orders. He needs his teammates to do the dirty work so he can go for the win.
You and Braz, cover anything that moves. Just sit on him. Do not work at all, no matter who it is. Jump on anything that moves before we hit that first climb, and just sit on him.
Pierce has come up with a plan to change bicycles at the top of Fremont Pass using one of the faster rolling high-tech disc wheels for the descent. It's never been done before at the Coors Classic.
Get enough of a gap and do the bike change with the disc wheel.
Do you have it all set?
It's all set to go. Do the bike change on the top and then go.
Back at the 7-Eleven van, team manager Jim Akowitz makes a dire prediction.
And there's going to be some dead bodies out there. I'm almost sure of it, that you're going to see some of these guys cracking today.
Then it's back to the bikes as they are fine-tuned for that day's racing.
Going into the Vail to Copper Mountain road race, Hinault had the momentum, and unless someone did something about it, the great champion was going to roll to a win at the Coors. The other teams had their plans on how to stop him, but there was also a lot of speculation that his own teammate LeMond had a plan for this race as well, to try and sneak into the race lead ahead of his fellow Red Zinger. Instead, it was the Badger, Hinault, who never let LeMond up for air, leaving the younger champion behind. It was Hinault and 12 others who got away, including Jeff Pierce, who had done what he needed to in order to make his bike change plan work. He had gotten to the top of Fremont Pass with the leaders.
Push him, push
him! Keep pushing!
Go, go, go! All of a sudden, this guy goes winging by us and going, woof, woof, woof. Oh man, that is novel. I mean, like, give me a break. There's no way he's gonna get away.
An interesting idea did not quite pan out. Pierce never escaped the field, and instead it was Martin Ducrot who took the win.
3 hours, 23 minutes, and 15 seconds.
It was nearly 2 minutes later that Greg LeMond rolled through the finish line. Hinault had put a hammerlock on his teammate.
Greg LeMond, Andrew Hampson, Raul Alcala.
Are you still in the hunt? Do you think you can still win?
I don't know. Bernard's, the same team. I'd like to still win, though. Yeah. You know, anything could happen. He could crack. Who knows? But it's looking pretty damn for me.
The women raced from Copper out over Fremont Pass to Climax and then back again. And the day belonged to Madonna Harris of the Centurion team. Showing great strength, she rode most of the race alone and held on to a good-sized lead. Finally rolling up the hill all alone for the win. For Madonna Harris, the next day would be as different as the weather. With only a few laps gone in the Estes Park circuit race, the wet weather spilled her down.
When I was chasing Jeannie, she had just gone for the 200-meter preem, and she had probably a 20-second gap, and so I was kind of bombing it. And I just, you know, started pedaling a little too soon, and so I came up with my saddle and let my back wheel go around. So next thing I knew, I was sliding across the road.
Estes Park was brutal on all the riders. The cold, wet weather made for miserable riding conditions, and even more importantly, it was very dangerous.
Okay.
The women's race saw the strength of Inga Benedict. Having been caught in the Madonna Harris crash, she trailed Jeannie Longo by about 30 seconds on a day where she could not afford to lose time. But with five laps to go, she put the hammer down and began a dogged pursuit of Longo. And when she caught her, she just kept on going right past her, finally winning by 29 seconds, pulling her back to within 1 minute and 16 seconds of Longo, who came in second. The men's race was won by Moreno Argentine of the Bianchi team, but the story of the day was Jeff Pierce. After the wheel change in the Vale de Capa race, he was in second, trailing Hinault by just over a minute. But on a short circuit course where it should have never happened, Pierce dropped almost 2.5 minutes to the leader.
I just had a bad day. Actually, I think through working with one of the doctors, we traced it back to a meal about a day or two ago, which didn't have a very good effect on my body.
So while the men's race was being gripped tighter and tighter by Bernard Hinault, the women's race was heating up, with Benedict and Longo squaring off.
That's her problem. I mean, there are a few American teams here, and as far as working together, I think that she just needs something to complain about, and that's the closest thing.
USA team, team of France, Canada.
On the morning before the Golden to Boulder women's race, Inga Benedict prepared to catch Jeannie Longo. Bad blood between the top two women had started to boil over into the public eye. The battle between the French woman and the American had been drawn on national lines.
With the bike race, sure, there's a duel going on. It's a bike race, and the two of us are racing each other. I mean, that's to be expected.
On the 57-mile ride, the two women watched each other. But while that took place, Centurion's Bunky Bunkitis and Red Zinger Leslie Schenck took off. That pair would stay away for the whole race, and when the final sprint came around, Schenck, who lives in Boulder, held off Bunkitis for a big win.
It's going to be Leslie Schenck!
But Schenck would earn greater publicity for a problem instead. Two nights before, she had drank some NyQuil for a cough. The next day, she was randomly selected for drug testing. After each race, five racers are tested from both the men's and women's field. The overall race leader, the top two finishers in that race, as well as two at random. Schenck tested positive for ephedrine, a banned substance and an ingredient in NyQuil. Schenck huddled with U.S. women's coach Sue Novara-Reber, but there was little that could be done. Schenck was disqualified from the Coors and is now battling to stave off a mandatory 30-day suspension that would keep her off the U.S. Worlds team. The men also raced from the brewery to Boulder, but their route had them in the mountains. And the first task they faced was a steep climb up Golden Gate Canyon. While the field was concerned with the climb, race leader Bernard Hinault had a private task to keep Phil Anderson and Greg LeMond in check. With Pierce dispatched in Estes Park, they were the only two who could threaten his lead. The descents on the course were fast and twisting. The bike handling was critical. A mistake here would prove very costly. Andy Hampston of the Levi's Pro Team stood in fourth place, over 3.5 minutes behind Hinault. He had to take chances if he were to try and win the Coors Classic. Hampston took off alone about a third of the way into the 87-mile race and opened up a good gap. The field got motivated and almost caught him at the 70-mile mark, but Hampston was able to pull away and again open up a good margin. However, as they neared the city limits, Hampston's dream of a solo win crumbled, and the finish was instead a field sprint.
And Greg LeMond, it's going to be
The broken dream then belonged to Greg LeMond, who seemed to have the sprint won when off his wheel came Russian Dmitry Konashev to steal the win.
I probably gave up too easily because I thought I had it. I didn't really push myself all the way to the end thinking I had it won, and he just came zipping by me.
Just nothing more than a derivation of English and German.
The Niwot time trial has never been the most exciting event in the classic, but the 1986 version was the best ever for two reasons: Inga Benedict and Bernard Hinault. They had dominated the other time trials so that it appeared certain Benedict would get back into the women's race, chasing Jeannie Longo, and that Hinault would once again thrill everyone with his unparalleled time trialing.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bernard Hinault!
Benedict was the only woman to still have a shot at Longo. She trailed her by an even minute going into the time trial. She would start just ahead of Longo. Again, showing the great individual strength necessary to succeed at this grueling event, she reeled off the best time of the day, covering the 8.4-mile out-and-back course in 19 minutes and 27 seconds.
1950.
Longo's time would be 25 seconds more, so Benedict had trimmed Longo's lead to just 35 seconds with three races left.
I was hoping to take over the leader's jersey. I think that's probably a little outlandish, hoping to get a minute, but I had the hopes of trying to get that minute. And the 25 seconds is definitely going to help.
Time trialing has never been as exciting as it is when Hinault is involved. It not only raises the interest level in the event, it seems to elevate the performance of the other riders, who know an off day could lead to an embarrassing difference when Hinault is done. Phil Anderson and Greg LeMond were just trying to hang on here. There was little, if any, hope they could outduel the leader on these grounds. Anderson actually seemed to labor under the pressure of battling the Badger. He would lose 32 seconds at Niwot. LeMond rose to the occasion and smoked the course. He had a fire in his eyes as he pursued the legend. He may not win the course, but to beat Hinault at his specialty would taste just as sweet. LeMond exploded across the line with by far the best time of the day. But the focus then shifted to Hinault, who was still on the course. As usual, the machine-like, detached state he was in seemed to make him invulnerable to fatigue. While LeMond waited at the finish line, Hinault continued in his relentless hypnotic state. When he finished, he had clipped 4 seconds off of LeMond's time to claim yet another time trial.
He is the winner, 1803!
And for LeMond, the taste was of a bitter defeat. Any other cyclist in the world would have been honored to have ridden an 8.5-mile time trial within 4 seconds of Bernard Hinault. That night, the race moved to Denver for the Criterium at the Tivoli Brewery, and things would change very much from the morning, everything from the weather to the racing. In the women's race, Jeannie Longo needed to reestablish her dominance that had eroded in the Niwot time trial. With her lead down near half a minute, she could not afford to show any weakness. The reason Longo is a champion is because she knows how to respond to pressure. And in Denver, a win at the Tivoli again pushed her lead back up over the 1 minute mark.
Look at this! The race leader, Jeannie Longo! Yes!
The men's race deteriorated into a battle of the few willing to risk the slippery streets.
God, we're having fun.
In a criterium, racers get a free lap when mechanical problems crop up. In the rain, a Davis Finney crash left him in the pits, and while waiting for repairs, his manager accidentally let the air out of his back tire.
Come on, God, I don't believe it!
Bill, give me some air. Bill.
Come on!
Finney was just barely able to rejoin the race where he left off, and that group pulled further and further away from the pack on each lap. Finally, it would be Finney sprinting in for the win. For Bernard Hinault, the Tivoli Criterium would be his weakest ride of the Classic. He elected to play it safe in the rain and lost over a minute to both LeMond and Anderson. They were again within 2 minutes of him with two races and 166 miles left.
It's
better to lose 1 minute than to lose the race.
Okay, thank you very much.
The Merkel Bismarck course lies out in the arid plains southeast of Boulder. It is a difficult course for the racers of the Coors Classic because it is so unpredictable. The weather can be extreme, from brutally hot and windy to bone-chilling rain and cold. The course itself is 13 miles with just under 900 feet of climbing. There are three short but steep hills. One is termed the feed hill, one aptly termed the hump, and the finishing hill is called the wall, all for obvious reasons. The Morgul is ridden late in the Coors Classic when the races are tired but can ill afford to coast. It can be a demoralizing day for some, a day of renewed hope for others. To win the Morgul, you must sprint up the long and increasingly steeper wall through a tunnel of noise that can be as oppressive as it can be encouraging due to the tremendous crowds which line the finishing stretch. This year, the women's race featured an early attempt by Inga Benedict to rise out of the shadow of race leader Jeannie Longo. When her move failed, it was a chance for nine lesser-known racers to slip off and gain 3.5 minutes on the field. In what was perhaps the gentlest weather day in Morgul history, the women sizzled to a new course record, and for the second year in a row, a West German would cross the finish line first. This year's champion of the Morgul was Uta Enzenauer, the 1981 world champion.
The men had a tougher task than usual, with an extra lap. For the first time, eight circuits would make up the race, totaling 105 miles. A group of eight men led most of the way, but at the start of the last 13-mile loop, Stefan Bricht of the Bianchi team takes off and does the last lap in impressive solo fashion. He comes across the line alone, over 2 minutes ahead of the field. Back in the pack, Hinault has never let Anderson or LeMond out of his sight.
Hinault still seemed very strong, and Greg too, and I tried a couple of times to get away, but they were always right there.
There was just one race left in the Coors, and the leads of Hinault and Longo both seemed safe.
Currently in first place overall, please welcome the defending champion of this race, Jeannie Longo!
While Jeannie Longo was dominating the women's field in the individual competition, an equally impressive win was being posted by the Centurion women in the team competition.
More than anything else, I'd like to see a team win. I mean, this is probably the most prestigious event in the entire Coors Classic, and I'd like to see us take it.
The Centurions were the only team with four equally strong racers, each with the potential to win a stage, and three of them did. Marianne Berglund, Bunky Bunkitis, Madonna Harris, and Susan Ehlers were never really challenged in the team competition, with the Soviet Union finishing over 21 minutes behind.
Go Centurion! Go Centurion!
It was the teamwork that gave Ehlers a chance to do something pretty impressive on the last day of the race, as she moved all the way from fourth up to second with a solo breakaway win that took almost 2 minutes out of Inga Benedict. While Ehlers was riding alone off the front, her teammates were blocking the chase and simply not allowing anyone a chance to go after her.
Here she comes, cracking
her. Ehlers' solo win was the last women's event of the Classic, one that saw Jeannie Longo win again, earning her second straight championship. But Ehlers' move to second made her the top-placing American, and her Centurion team stood atop the podium as titleists. The men's race on the last day was won by Ron Kiefel. It was kind of fitting that Kiefel won the last race, as he won on the first day as well. But the top honor went to Bernard Hinault. The 31-year-old went out in style, atop the podium as champion in his last stage race. Finishing second was Greg LeMond. Those two will once again battle in Colorado Springs at the World Championship Pro Road Race on September 6th.
On a une très bonne équipe et...
He thinks that he has a good team for the World Championships. And it's reasonable to think that the team can win the World Championships.
There's something psychological when you don't win a race that drives you on for the next race. And I could tell that, you know, I'm already starting to think about it. And I'm going to be psyched up for it, especially if it's in America.
So once again, the two great racers will butt heads. One big difference will be their affiliations. No longer teammates, they'll be racing for their countries instead. And once again, they'll face the challenge. While the Coors Classic tests the body over 2 weeks, the Worlds is a one-shot deal, a 162-mile test that only one man can win. The Coors Classic has served a dual purpose. As usual, it's been a world-class sporting event, but it has also served as the training ground for those in quest of the World Championship. On September 6th, we'll see who trained the best. With Connie Carpenter, I'm Tom Green, saying goodnight.